know that we launched a four-day series on Monday, and that was the result of a six-month investigation that our organization undertook. That investigation started because of what began as a simple conversation that we in Carolina Public Press had with someone. I heard, he said, that our DA doesn't prosecute sexual assaults. To be clear, that person is not alone in Fayetteville, and that DA is not in Cumberland County. But that is a question and a statement that we turned into a question. We turned into multiple questions. We took that phrase, and one question became hundreds of questions. It became more than 6 months of reporting. And it became a collaboration of 11 news organizations, including the Fayetteville Observer, who's here today, and they are going to be reporting about this event for tomorrow's newspaper. So we want people to do that. It became three listening sessions, including one here in Fayetteville. Some of you attended that. And participants across the state included survivors, law enforcement, North Carolina Department of Justice, healthcare providers, policymakers, attorneys, advocates, victim service providers, and those concerned with what's happening in our communities and in our state when it comes to this issue. It became 30-plus people working to produce journalism that includes what is thought to be the first comprehensive analysis of court records detailing what happened in sexual assault cases in every single county in the state. It became an investigative reporting project seeking conviction, justice, and elusive for North Carolina sexual assault survivors. We started publishing and broadcasting the reporting on Monday. Right now, it's been republished or broadcast on at least a dozen and counting news organizations across the state because there are some important findings. At Carolina Public Press, we analyzed 4.5 years of court records and specifically examined rape charges involving threats, force, intimidation, or an incapacitated person. And what we found is that across the state, fewer than 1 in 4 defendants charged with sexual assault are convicted. We found in 38 counties, there were no reported convictions at all in cases that began and ended during those 4.5 years. Not even
when you prosecute, and your end state sometimes is a jury trial. So either you have a plea deal or you go to trial. And when you go to trial, you have to take into account what the public sentiment is, how likely you are able to get a conviction. And a lot of that is education of the public. And I think now more we have progressed as a society where we are more likely probably to get a conviction than we were, say, 50 years ago. However, there's still a lot of education to be done. And the biggest challenge is, and I think you have it in your later questions, is things like TV, CSI, SVU, things like that, where the public is not well educated. So they think they are because they watch these shows, but in reality, our cases aren't like that. And you get juries that expect that. And I think that that's probably the biggest challenge in trying to prosecute these cases, that the public, who are our jurors when we go to trial, don't know what these cases actually look like and what a sex assault victim presents as, or what the case looks like when you take it to trial.
And to piggyback off of what Bella just said, when we take a case to trial during jury selection, typically in a case like this, we will have only about a day and a half to talk to jurors during voir dire, that process. And it's a very limited amount of time that we can speak to them and find out what their preconceived notions may be about these types of assault, and also find out what their biases may be and try to rule out jurors. But there are still some things that remain hidden, and you don't know what's in the back of that juror's mind when they go into that deliberation.
Thank you all very much. And I'll share, you both just mentioned some things. We heard over and over again in the series as we talked with district attorneys and assistant district attorneys and police officers throughout the state, this issue of the challenge of jurors that have preconceived notions, that have hidden biases, and who think they're not supposed to work because they've watched too much SVU. I want to ask Deanne a question that we'll address and we'll probably talk with John about as well. But Fayetteville has a police department that has received recognition for being proactive in prosecution or preparation of cases for prosecution in sexual assault. As somebody who works with victims in this area, what kind of an impact do you see for survivors of sexual assault because of the way the police are operating?
I think a number of ways. One, when our community sees a proactive police department, that they're taking this crime seriously, it gives them a better feeling about reporting their own crime, right? So it's not, and then that's now spread nationwide, right? So we have the Me Too movement, and Time's Up, and Bill Cosby, and you know, the whole nation is talking about sexual assault now. So victims don't feel alone. So bringing it back to Fayetteville, they see that LT and his team are taking this seriously, right? They're investigating it. And then just moving it forward to the whole team, right? This is our team, and we have lots of other people that are on this team, but even when we enter the emergency room with a victim, and they see us all working together, that we have trust and faith and we're talking to each other, it comforts the victim so that it's not as awkward as it could be if there's that roof that honestly used to be there. 10 years ago when I first started, it was like, we were oil and water. So we've come a long way. And I just want to piggyback on what Bella said, you know, about the CSI effect for jurors or potential jurors. We also see that with victims, right? They've watched the same shows that jurors watch, so they have these expectations as well as jurors. Like, I've seen Law & Order 5 million times because it's been on for 50 years. So we've all watched victims have almost those same expectations. Like law enforcement's gonna swoop in and do their job, and the DA's office is gonna put on this fabulous case. There's gonna be a little bump in the road, but conviction's gonna happen. It's gonna be sent away forever. Lieutenant Somerindyke, our series starts looking at a person when they're charged and then what happens after that. What I want to ask you is what determines which complaints of sexual assault results in arrests and then goes to the DA for prosecution?
Yeah, I mean, I really wish I could say we're putting all dirtbag rapists in jail for every case, but that's not a really realistic approach to take with these cases. You know, we do the best we can, and we have to take that into account too. Just you know, like I've said before, society is our jury pool. You're our jury pool. You know, the typical person on the street's our jury pool. So we have to kind of keep that in the back of our mind when we're investigating these cases. I mean, it seems like a lot of these cases on face value are open and shut. Hey, she said he forcibly had sex with her. What are you waiting for? You know, why aren't you drawing charges? But you know, with these cases and with society being as it is, and it really just takes one person to buy into victim blaming on a jury, and your case is all shot to hell. So really it comes about, you know, corroborating everything. I mean, if our victim said she went and got a Big Mac, you know, earlier that day, we'll get video from McDonald's or something. And on the flip side, you know, you're fair to the defendant also, but also if you can catch him in lies, simple lies like that. If he said he went to Burger King, but he really didn't go to Burger King. So it's really a long process, just both trying to build up your victim's credibility, trying to find the truth is the ultimate goal, but build up your victim's credibility. You know, you do investigation on the suspect, you know, his background, his movement for the day or days leading up to it. And we really have to take all that into account. In addition to, you know, to the CSI stuff, and of course getting every new evidence test. It's nice to have DNA, but a lot of our cases we don't have DNA. Both of our reports are delayed. There is no DNA, there is no evidence, there is no crime scene to immediately process. So it's difficult. You know, we try to be as thorough as we can. And, you know, if we had it my way, we charge everybody with everything, but it doesn't always work out that way. It's not a realistic approach to have.
The next question I have is for Liz, but I'm going to share something about your occupation as we develop this series. And for those who have been following in publication, in what's going to come out tomorrow, we emphasize the role of medical professionals, particularly sexual assault nurse examiners like yourself. In screening our articles, we've worked with a media law expert, who is certainly an expert in North Carolina law, but not necessarily criminal law. And she, one of the strongest expressions she came back to me with, besides wanting a few wording changes here and there, was to say, I am so moved by what the same nurses do. I wish I could go out and fund so that we would have same nurses at every hospital in every county in North Carolina, but we don't. Having said that, can you talk to us a little bit, Liz, about what your role is as a same nurse, particularly here in the Fayetteville area?
That's very moving, it's very complimentary, and I just want to say that it is a huge injustice to victims if they are not cared for by someone who is trained specifically to take care of sexual assault victims. That is not something you learn in nursing school, and it's certainly not something that physicians learn in medical school. So I will tell you that the sexual assault nurse examiners, we set up our program and we got our program. We base our program on best practice, on CDC guidelines. We have to learn a lot about forensics. So we actually do the total care of the patient. The physician does sign off on labs and medication, but we even tell them what labs and medication to order. I mean, we actually run our program. Hospitals that do not have a SANE program, many of the RNs are very intimidated to do a sexual assault exam, because I think we all want to do the best job we can to take care of our patients. But if you haven't been properly trained to take care of a sexual assault patient, you really don't know where to start. We do get a lot of phone calls from some
of the rural hospitals that maybe don't have a SANE program, but sometimes they have one or two SANE trained nurses, but maybe their cases aren't frequent enough that they do a lot of these. I do think that we have helped in collecting DNA from these kits, perpetrator DNA, and ultimately been helpful in prosecutions. The patient has choices when they come to us, and our primary goal is the medical care of that patient, but then we explain other options. Some of them will choose to do anonymous kits, some of them will go forward with a report, but they have that time to make that decision with someone who's trained and knows to give them that time. We don't push them or encourage them in any way whatsoever.
So this is for Bella and Alicia. We asked Lieutenant Somerindyke how the case moves to your office, and I'd like to ask you if you could describe the process of how a case moves from the police to your office. Is every case reviewed, or does someone select it? What criteria do you use when deciding when and whether to prosecute a case?
When cases are charged in our jurisdictions that are particularly felony cases, they are first assigned to an assistant DA in district court. That assistant DA is called a felony screener. They will screen cases and decide what's appropriate to be pled down in district court and what's appropriate to be sent to the grand jury and indicted to superior court. Most likely all sexual assault cases will be indicted to superior court or sent to the grand jury for them to decide whether it will be a true bill of indictment or not a true bill. If it's not a true bill, it's dead there. If they find a true bill, it will go up to superior court and it will be assigned to a trial attorney like me or Ms. Truong. And we have to look at those cases on a case-by-case basis and decide which ones to offer plea deals to or which ones to take to trial if a defendant does reject.
As you have observed what happens with the survivors that you work with, do you see differences between how cases are handled here versus what you see maybe in outlying areas surrounding Cumberland County?
It's a great question. I don't know if I have the answer to it. So we work a lot with Fort Bragg, which is a completely different entity. Generally, if it's out of Cumberland County, so if we get a victim and they're out of the county, that generally means they came to Cape Fear Valley for medical, right? So generally speaking, we do a warm handoff back to their home county so that they can receive services there. So I don't really have an answer to that. Sorry. Lieutenant Somerindyke, could you describe how your officers are trained in trauma-informed communication and investigation?
Yeah, I'll tell you, when I came to the Special Victims Unit, it was September 2014. I had never heard the term victim-centered, didn't understand that concept at all. I'd never heard of neurobiology of trauma. Didn't get that concept at all. Luckily things worked out where that following year we were awarded the Sexual Assault Kit Initiative Grant, both in 2015 and 2016. We've been exposed to some great training through that program. We are really blessed. I was really pleasantly surprised to see Liz Herring here. I was telling you, she runs one of the best SANE programs in the state. But we're also blessed to have at Womack Army Hospital probably somebody just as equal to Liz and Kelly Taylor. She's the head SANE nurse at Womack Army Hospital. She is actually, I consider her a national expert on neurobiology of trauma. So she is good enough to teach our police academies that subject for free, for now at least. And she charges nationwide to teach that. So we have that going, and with our Sexual Assault Kit Initiative grant, we actually, with the 2016 grant, we got $15,000 in cash to, we hired Blue Line Training Group. They're based out of South Carolina. They actually created a 4-hour training for all of our sworn officers. It's like a basic sexual assault investigation and response type of training. And then just, you know, the and I believe the state, with Josh Stein with his new initiative, I think he's going to mandate that type of neurobiology training. So we'll be seeing it again, hopefully, in the near future. Here will be a refresher for us.
Well, that's a good segue into the next question I have, which is for Liz. You mentioned a little bit about the process, becoming a senior. It's different than just becoming an RN or something. I wonder if you could elaborate that. And also about one of the things we've heard a lot as we talk to people in different parts of the state. Fayetteville is fortunate to have the program that you're running here, but there are other places that don't have that. You talked a little bit about the access to San Luis, not necessarily picking on any particular location, but realize not everybody has the resources. But just what that's like, you know, how common is it for people to have to travel a long distance to see a St. Nurse or something?
One of the things about healthcare, they look at programs and that are generated programs, sometimes cardiac, orthopedic, whatever. Sexual assault is pretty much an indigent program. We are not a high revenue, we're not bringing in money. So that's always a downside for hospitals that do not have a SANE program. We are very fortunate to have a program, and we're fortunate because our sister hospital at Womack has a program, and we pretty much take care of all of Cumberland County. Cape Fear Valley has actually 5 hospitals now that we're managing under our umbrella. Layton Hospital we own. We have a hospital in Hope County that we own, and we are managing the 2 hospitals in Harnett County now. So we have actually same trained nurses in all of those facilities. But a lot of the rural hospitals do not have money to start up programs. Training is expensive. Board of Nursing has very few training sites in the state, and it's about $600-$700 a participant, and that's not including flying someone there, hotel rooms and food, and paying for someone to cover their shifts on the floor while they're in training. So all these things are fairly expensive, and as more grants are coming forward, I hope to see that we are putting more SANE trained nurses in the hospital. So far, we're regulated by accreditation committee called Joint Commission, JACO, some of you may have heard of them. And so far, they have not mandated that sexual assault victims are cared for by a sexual assault nurse examiner or someone specifically trained, but they do mandate that your hospital does have some sort of training and has the equipment available. But that can vary very vastly.
We touched on this a little bit earlier. This is a question for Bella and Alicia about you know, people who watch these procedural police shows like SVU, Crime Scene, whatever. By the way, I just saw one of those for the first time yesterday, so I kind of know what you're talking about now when you're looking at those. And regarding juries and their expectations, talk to us about those challenges with the juries of people who've seen these shows. And I don't know, there's a few DAs who talk to us about the conversations they have with juries afterward, and while they try their best to screen the juries from having these people on them, they're not always successful.
I think if you talk to a lot of prosecutors, one of the main things that's frustrating for us, once you try a case, they find the defendant not guilty, go back and talk to the jury. We have all heard it at least once, probably many times, is the jurors will say, I believed her or him, but I wanted more. And so for a prosecutor, the victim's testimony is evidence. And for the most part, jurors, there's a disconnect, right? So then for them, they see a victim's testimony as testimony. they don't see it as evidence. And what they consider evidence is something like DNA or an eyewitness. And to them, that's evidence. That is proving it to me, not simply the victim's word. And it's frustrating for a prosecutor because for us, that is evidence. That is somebody who was there who was telling you what happened. And for the most part, with juries watching TV shows, it is all about corroborative evidence. And that is important. That is something that we should have with cases. However, it's not always possible because rapes generally don't happen out in the open in the middle of the street. They happen in a dark bedroom where the perpetrator has nobody watching him. And so that's the reality. And in this day and age where, you know, you have the ability to gather DNA or you have cell phones or you have things like that, it becomes more important and they expect that more. And it's hard to overcome it when you're faced with a jury who believes everything she says but says, I want more. Like, that's just not enough.
Deanne, in the work that you do, I know that people come to you sometimes as the first person they have contact with in your organization. And oftentimes you have to help them to figure out how they navigate the system, if that's what they want to do. They may make a different choice. But if they want to talk to law enforcement about that, if they want to undergo examination and so on, can you talk a little bit about what it's like as you work that part of the process and helping them? Working with whichever jurisdiction, whether it's Cumberland County or Fayetteville or one of the other smaller municipalities they're dealing with. What is that like? What's your role in that process?
So when a victim does come to us, it's not an automatic reporting, right? We want to make sure that we give a victim all the information that we have to make their own choice, whether that is reporting or isn't reporting, or counseling or not counseling, or moving, or whatever it is. We want to empower everyone with our information for them to make their own decision. So if they make the decision that they want to report, I honestly hope that it's the Fayetteville jurisdiction, because it's just easier. We will call whoever our contact is in the jurisdiction that the crime happened. So we do ask that question. We don't really ask victims a lot of questions. We don't ask a story or who the perpetrator was, but we do have to ask the jurisdiction so we can get the right person. And we call. We'll call LT, and we have a victim at our office, and he sends someone over. And most jurisdictions will send law enforcement over. Whether they need medical or not, that's determined. We'll go to the hospital with them and just get law enforcement involved. And it's up to each jurisdiction on how they handle it. If it's a road officer, if it's a detective, if it's a full interview, if it's just the who, what, where, why questions. But it will be done in our office.
So Lieutenant Somerindyke, we talked quite a bit for the story that we're writing that's running tomorrow about sort of your change of heart throughout your career and how you interview rape victims. I'm wanting to know if you can talk to us about how your perceptions of victims, how the way you interview them and sort of how their emotions, how you perceive their emotions has changed over the years of your career. And also, if you don't mind, how your department has changed as a result of that, how your processes have improved.
Yeah, I'll answer the second part first. So yeah, just really can't say enough, our exposure to the resources from the Sexual Assault Kit Initiative grant really have improved our response to sexual violence over the past 4 years or so. But yeah, me personally, I investigated rapes back in the 90s, and I always didn't do that great a job. You know, I thought I was this great detective, and the victim's story would change, or she wasn't really making sense. And I'm this great detective. Well, she must be lying. Her story changed. She's just not making sense. She's lying. She wasn't raped. So, there's a science to that, though. And we understand that now. And I didn't always do that great a job in the and early 2000s investigative briefs. So, you know, like I said, when I was moved to my current assignment in 2014, I was exposed to these concepts, and they're relatively new concepts still that we're trying to understand. Yeah, but now we know, you know, why stories do change. You know, trauma affects memory. And so we try to give victims a sleep cycle or two before we do a thorough, in-depth interview. Every circumstance is different, of course. But yeah, just with the resources from the grant, and you know, PERF is coming, the Police Executive Research Forum, they came in here a few years ago too and did an assessment of our unit, which we really learned a lot from. It helped, you know, towards significant improvements in our policy. I mean, our policy outline, doing background checks on victims and, you know, done stuff like that. It's just very unvictim-centered, which, you know, that's, again, another phrase I was never exposed to. I never understood that concept, but, you know, the bottom line, the victim's safety, well-being, and most importantly, choice are the priorities for all of our cases now. I think we're starting to get that a little bit more as a department, and hopefully my profession will catch on here soon.
So the next question is for Liz, but after this, we have some more questions we can ask, but I think we want to stop for a minute and see if there's some questions from you all. But I want to ask Liz this first. As we think about the role of SANERS in particular, are there some things that you can think of that could be improved with the way the process works, and not necessarily just locally, there could be things locally, but particularly around the state. Not saying the process, but I mean in particular, you know, the requirements that are there for interaction between state nurses and other people that are part of this process. What can be done differently that might improve outcomes and might make sense?
The biggest thing that I see that can improve the process overall is, and I'm going to use a slogan that In Violence Against Women organization uses, is that we start by believing. That every member of the team, that you start by believing. And just like Lieutenant Somerindyke pointed out, many victims will come in and they might not be able to fill in all the holes in their story initially. There's going to be parts that they forget. They're not intentionally leaving those parts out or lying. It is because when you have a traumatic event that your brain kind of scrambles that information. And if you guys can think of a traumatic event in your own personal life, and maybe a family member was in a bad car accident, I had that experience, and the details started coming back to me later, but I couldn't even tell you what I had on. I went to the scene, and I couldn't even tell you what I was wearing that day. So those things, your brain kind of just freezes when things happen to you, so those victims aren't intentionally lying. The other thing that comes to mind is working together as a team. We have an awesome sexual assault response team in Cumberland County. I work on a daily basis with Deanne and Lieutenant Somerindyke, and then with the DA's office frequently. And we are all part of a team. We have mutual respect for what each other does. So anything that we can do to be helpful to each other or to help out that victim, we're certainly willing to do that. In some of the smaller counties, you don't have that. I know that we've had some struggle in some of the outlying counties that Cape Fear Valley manages now because they did not have an organized sexual assault team. You do not know who your go-to person is for a certain resource that person needs. Sometimes we have victims come in and there's red flags that maybe they're a human trafficking victim. Well, we know now we can reach out to Federal PD and they can get in touch with our Five Sparrows team, human trafficking team that comes in and helps us with that. Some of the smaller communities do not have these type of resources and they don't know who their go-to person is because they don't have an organized team.
Yeah, so do we have any questions from the audience? Anyone?
I actually have a question.
Yeah, sure. I'll repeat it so everybody can hear.
Okay, as far as communication goes,
that would have been one less inconsistency from someone who had been through trauma. But I'm just curious how, what your suggestions are to better communicate. And it sounds like you guys do a great job of working together as a team and passing that information along from the detectives to the prosecutor's office. But how did you get to that point to where, and how much do you involve the victim as it's like clarify things like McDonald's? And you do have to, you know, you have PTSD, so sometimes communication is a little difficult for me. But how can we stop that gap, you know, of information there?
So I'm going to try and summarize that.
Please.
Hopefully I will get it right. But she's asking how DAs and detectives can improve their communication process because of your personal experience in having some incorrect information passed on and then later taken as gospel.
Exactly.
Okay.
As written as part of the dismissal.
Yeah, great question. Thank you. So, yeah, I can answer a couple ways. First, the case review that Ms. Marks brought up earlier, that's one way that their initial level screeners will kind of catch things that maybe we need to do a little better. And that's all in writing. I think there's a form they fill out. It goes back to that detective supervisor. Hey, we recommend you do this, this, and this to shore up the case a little bit. To answer your question about victims, yes, certainly they're going to be involved in the process. I mean, if there's something we're missing, if there's something, you know, they feel we need to do or look into, we'll certainly definitely entertain that. And we'll take into account, you know, their, you know, whatever they have to say towards the investigation, and even whether they want an investigation or not. If they want us to stop and not, you know, proceed forward, but we'll respect their wishes for sure. We want to try to keep them in, as involved as possible, you know, as part of that choice to be the victim center. Also, we're lucky enough, I think it's been maybe 3 or 4 years ago, Mr. Billy West, the district attorney, and my then chief of police, Mr. Chief Medlock from Charlotte area, we got together, me and Alicia were actually part of that meeting, so we got together and, you know, Chief Medlock and Billy West thought it was important to improve the communication with the district attorney's office, specifically with sexual assault cases. So yeah, we have an agreement in place still today, and I think actually one of my detectives was talking to Alicia about some cases, and she was going to look into some things and get back with us, but basically we have an agreement in place for rape cases that really, more probably the gray area, the ones that we're sure need to be charged, and ASAP, I think we're pretty confident in charging with some of our cases, and I think it's more of the gray area cases where we know maybe there's a little more we can do to shore it up. We'll put together a case file as if we did make an arrest, and everything will be in that case file except, you know, the arrest warrants. And we'll either, I prefer dropping it off. I know Alicia's good enough, and Bella too, with their time. Sometimes they'll actually take time out of their day when we just drop in on them out of the blue to sit down with us and review a case file. You know, and they're overworked enough as it is. So we have that agreement in place, and they kind of, and they'll tell it how it is. I mean, if we need to do more with it, you know, we'll do more with it. If it's just one of those cases that, you know, unfortunately, not all of them are prosecutable. It's just one of those cases. We will, as a team, figure out a way to respectfully tell that news to our survivors.
And I just want to add a little bit to this conversation about standards of proof. A lot of times it gets lost in translation. Victims don't understand that to get criminal charges, all that is required is probable cause. And that's the standard that law enforcement goes by when they decide whether to go to a magistrate and seek charges. Then you have two different standards of proof somewhere in the middle for civil cases, clear and convincing evidence or preponderance of the evidence. But in criminal cases, the standard that we are held to at the DA's office is beyond a reasonable doubt. And it's a very high standard. It's the highest standard of proof that we have in the judicial process. And what we kind of developed is a multidisciplinary team approach to looking at these cases. And Lieutenant Somerindyke and his team understands very well that investigation does not stop at probable cause. And when we look at these cases and taking them to trial, we have to take a fresh look at some of those things to see if we can get to beyond a reasonable doubt. And he knows that I've called his detectives, and I try to send them back out to shore things like that up. From what I saw in earlier cases, I started doing these in about 2015, going to see if there is a crime scene. Sometimes there is a delay in reporting, but we've had some add one thing. One of the things that North Carolina has done this past year that has really improved victim services is we've added a tracking system. Department of Justice now has a tracking system whereby you can see where your evidence, when we take that at the hospital, it goes from us to law enforcement. From there, when it goes to a crime lab, and then when it's actually processed. So that seemed like a small step, but it was a giant step to help empower our victims so that now at any given point, they can see and track their own evidence. And that's one of the things that we are frequently asked when we take the evidence in the hospital, where does that go from here? We're taking these saliva samples and these blood samples and all these things from that victim, and they want to know, what are you doing with that? Where does it go? How long does it take? When will you know if there's DNA? Some victims even think that the hospital is the one that processes the kit. So there's a lot of explanation, and we do need to involve our victims. We do need to keep you informed. That is so important.
I wanted to ask a question. It's getting on something you mentioned. You talked about the cases where a pattern emerges later, and they say, okay, let's go back and reinvestigate these crime scenes, for instance. Is that potentially even involving a case, say, not an acquittal because of double jeopardy, but if there is a dismissal, is it possible to do evidence like that could lead to that case being prosecuted after all? Is that at least theoretically possible?
Yes, it is. And when you have things that emerge later, say you have DNA, and that comes up now with rape kits being tested, that if there was a case where before we didn't have enough evidence or we didn't think that we could go forward and it was retested, and then it emerges that there's probably a serial rapist or that sort of behavior, and it was dismissed prior, we do have the ability and the authority to reopen the case, and we actually have done that in a series of serial rapists that we have. Obviously, we can't talk about pending cases, but we do have pending cases where that has come up.
Anybody else in the audience?
We have another question from the audience. Let me try and summarize. So the question was, as younger people get on the jury rolls through voter ID or voter registration and driver's license information, that's who the juries are pulled from. Do you think that Me Too and the R. Kelly effect will change the way that jurors see these cases?
Yeah, how's this? So, man, that's a good question, a tough question. Really, I think any increase in public awareness the media's given us for any of these cases, we're seeing a lot of high-profile cases. It's nice to see people in high positions finally being held accountable. I don't think that was happening in the recent years past. So, I personally think that's a good thing as far as raising awareness and how that would affect jury pools. You know, I'm so down on potential jurors, just I've been disappointed so many times. I don't know how it can get any worse, to be honest with you. But I think, especially if I'm hearing right, the like how are younger jurors? I mean, I would like to think maybe younger people are a little more open and receptive to what's going on with a lot of this, the Me Too movement, and a lot of what's going on with R. Kelly and you know, a lot of the other people who are finally being held accountable, people that they may have looked up to at one time or something. And maybe they're thinking in the back of their mind, hey, R. Kelly did this, and you know, hey, anybody could do something. I don't know. I don't know if that's kind of what you're asking, but I'm a little, you know, I'm always pleased with any kind of public awareness brought up in the media. You know, it kind of helps sell my product a little bit, and hopefully, you know, it'll help persuade some jurors to be a little more open-minded when it comes to being on a jury. I hope that answered that.
Generational pool is gonna really grasp it, right? Like, I think the issue is still gonna be there with DNA. They're gonna want it. They're gonna expect it. And it's still not going to be there, right? So I think that's a really good question, but it's time to tell.
I believe you were referencing the Kavanaugh hearing?
Yes.
Yes, she was asking about a potential negative impact from the publicity surrounding, for instance, the Kavanaugh hearing, where there was a lot of emphasis on he said, she said it, with that case. Is that my, am I summarizing?
Yes.
I'm going to give her a press
I'll try. So Kavanaugh was really interesting. You either believed it or you didn't. There wasn't a lot of gray area with that, right? Anytime there is such a national spotlight, Cosby, Brock Turner, the Hollywood, what's his face guy?
Weinstein,
thank you, yeah. There seems to be so many of them now, right? But that's a good thing, and I'm probably not answering your direct question, but yes, when the Kavanaugh thing happened, our phone lines and nationwide phone lines went up. The hotlines just lit up. Rain couldn't keep up with the amount of calls that there were because it triggers, right? But it's conversations and things like that that are, and things that Fayetteville Police are doing that is getting victims to come forward. So, yeah, it's helpful.
Start. I'll summarize, but also partially answer it. I was one of the writers on the article, and it was part of a partnership with Carolina Public Press, the Federal Observer, and a total of 11 media partners across the state. That story resulted from reporting, especially that Kate did, analyzing courtroom data, courthouse data from across North Carolina, the UK, got from the administrative office reports going back 4.5 years, looking at a time window from January 1st, 2014 to June 30th of 2018, and cases that began and ended during that time. So not looking at cases that were lagging over, not looking at cases that had begun earlier and finally ended, but looking specifically at cases where there was an open door and a shut door with a defendant charge, and then that number of defendants. Of those whose cases were resolved, what percentage resulted in a conviction? That was what we were looking at. And that rate of those specific types of defendants with those specific types of sexual assault charges we looked at didn't include misdemeanor type charges, we didn't include child sex cases, not because they're not important, but because they're prosecuted a bit differently, investigated a bit differently. And so we were specifically looking at forcible rape charges and related charges that are felonies of criminal. I mean, with those caveats, we found roughly 1 in 4, and this was statewide. This is not specific to any jurisdiction. We looked at the same rules for the entire state. You're asking, what can we do to change that to make it better? I just wanted to clarify where we're coming from with that story and what its basis was. Anybody care to jump in on that?
Very specific in terms of what you all have defined conviction, and that's one of, I think, six to eight charges. For our office, we have to look at the case on a case-by-case basis, and we have to be guided by the law and be guided by the evidence. And so a lot of times there are plea offers, there are plea deals, the defendant pleads down to something lower, which is not included in the six or eight charges, which, you know, the reporting has not counted as a conviction, but for our office, it is counted as a conviction. And by and large, the vast majority of our victims, because we consult with them prior, generally we consult with them prior to resolving the case, that they are satisfied with the result. So we have to be guided by that. We cannot be guided by percentages and conviction numbers, because at the end of the day, we have to be on the side of justice. And justice may look different for each and every case. And also with regards to the 1 in 4, there's, you know, at least 23% that get dismissed because the victim does not want to proceed or we cannot locate the victim. And so that's also accounted for in these numbers. And those are cases that we simply cannot do anything with. And so with regards to conviction rates, we don't guide ourselves by the conviction rates. Are there things in the process that everybody can do better? Absolutely. And are we trying to do that to have better communication, better investigations, get better corroborative evidence so we can do better in these cases? Absolutely. But in terms of what we do and how we do it, we can't say, well, we're doing this so we can get a better conviction rate, because if we do that, then we are not.
I do want to clarify one thing, and I appreciate it once again. I do want to clarify one thing about what we counted as convictions for the report. So there were a lot of tricky questions. Should this case be in? Should this case be out? There was a week there where Kate and I went over this very carefully and looked at a lot of nuances in the law. So we had to make choices. But in the end, we did not count cases where the charge was dropped and the person accepted a plea to another charge. That's one type of plea deal. And certainly there are people who are not on the street today because of those deals. It's not that those are unimportant deals. But what we did count as a conviction is if a person, say, was charged with forcible rape, first degree forcible rape or second degree forcible rape, and it was pled down to a related charge where that charge was reduced, we did count that as a conviction for the purposes of the report. So just to be clear about that.
I'll just clarify.
Yeah, yeah.
So in terms of reduction versus, There aren't very many lesser includeds to these types of charges. So just because we don't reduce it doesn't necessarily mean they don't plead to a sexual-related charge or a sexual assault type conviction. And with regards to that, our percentages are actually around 70% versus the, you know, what was reported. So if they pled to something related to the sex crime, and it's not necessarily a lesser included, it's a, because there aren't very many lesser included to the first degree rape and second degree rape, does not mean that they did not plead to something that was sexual assault.
Statute of limitations on felonies in North Carolina. I don't know in what jurisdiction your crime occurred.
South Carolina.
But we, I tried a case in 2016 where the offense date was 1991. I recently tried a sexual assault where the offense date was 1998 and we had DNA evidence. We actively look at all of the cases where we still have a kit on the shelf that may not have been processed and they send it. We also have cases where it has been sent to the lab. Do not know who the suspect is, but it goes into a database, and we may get a match later on when the offender has been convicted of a criminal offense that requires his DNA to be in that database, and we get a hit, and law enforcement investigates that case. They apply for a search warrant. If it's granted, they go get that suspect's DNA and see if there's a one-to-one match, and they contact the victims and reopen and reinvestigate that case. So I know as far as the Fayetteville Police Department is concerned and our office with our cold case unit, we are actively looking at those cases and charging them if we have enough evidence to go for.
No, great timing for your question. We actually just made an arrest today in the 1985 rape, and that's the case Alicia's been helping us with, so, and Billy West, the district attorney here in his office. So yeah, we'll look into any case, no matter how old it is. Yeah, we have evidence going back to the mid-80s, or even we're reopening a case from early 1980s where we have no evidence, so we're just going to kind of start from scratch and try to do an old-school rape investigation and run it by Alicia and Bella to see if it's prosecutable. So, yeah, we'll, in theory here, in any cases, is prosecutable no matter how much time has went by. And, we got a good team here that we work with that will give us honest, no BS answers and tell us, either we got it or we don't, and if there's room for improvement to tell. Just clarify, your case was not in Fayetteville, though?
No, it was in South Carolina.
Oh, okay, thank you. Okay, I'm sorry that happened to you, though.
According to Ring, South Carolina doesn't have a statute of limitations.
I was going to speak to, we do have something called anonymous kits or blind reporting, and I imagine South Carolina has something similar. In the Army, it's in the military, it's called restrictive reporting, but it's pretty much the same. But that means we can go ahead and collect your evidence in the emergency department if that's what you wish to do. Foremost, our primary concern is treating you medically and prophylactically for any STD. But if that person is not sure, they're undecided whether they want to report, we'll go ahead and collect that evidence because it's not something we can go back and get should you decide, a month, down the road, it's going to be gone. DNA, actually, with all the advances, we are finding that we can collect DNA up to about, statistics say up to about 12 days if there's penile-vaginal penetration. And we have been able to collect DNA longer and longer. So Lieutenant Somerindyke and his team will call frequently and say, this type of assault happened, that can that person still get a kit? And we try our best to collect whatever we can collect. Should you do anonymous reporting within a year, our crime lab custodian people at the LESS department, which is houses the anonymous kids, they contact that victim to see what they want to do with that kid at that point. But I do know we keep them longer than a year. I think the last I heard, we had some kids that are still there up to like 7 years. They said we'll keep them until like as long as we have space, because we do want to give victims adequate time to come forward.
Right. I almost forgot that I wrote this because it was a while ago. But we wrote another story about rape kits in the legislation in the state house. You know, the state used to have the most untested rape kits in the entire country, and I believe Lieutenant, you had told me that Cumberland County's number has been reduced to zero as of January, right?
Fayetteville PD.
I apologize. Yeah, Fayetteville PD as of January. Was it? And you guys had how many?
Over 600.
Yeah.
In 2015.
Yeah, Fayetteville had over 600 in 2015 untested rape kits. And so. So there's a whole story you can look for, you know, coming up about the rape kit issue. One question in the back? So the question is, she understands, you know, the issues with jurors, but what sort of stances should we be looking for in our elected officials to increase these prosecution rates? If anyone feels like with your boss sitting
right there. Just a quick comment. I mean, I really do. I've had a chance to meet the North Carolina Attorney General Josh Dine a couple of times, and I really like where he's going with his vision of these types of investigations, to where, you know, all sexual assault kits need to be tested, and really the type of training that he envisions bringing to statewide law enforcement. So just from my perspective, Seth's perspective, I kind of appreciate that. And I do believe he's mentioned the district attorneys being on board for summer, all of that too. So I know that's kind of a conglomerate of high power officials in this state agreeing that we do have an issue and that we need to fix it. And I think he's leading by example. He's the top attorney in the state, and he's leading by example for all the DAs in the state, the way, you know, these cases should be working, what we should be doing now when we didn't do the right thing long ago. If that's kind of accurate, hopefully.
Jump in on that, not to give my opinion. I used to be an editorial writer for the Fayetteville Observer, but I don't do opinion work these days. But I do want to give an observation on that question. In doing this series, we talked, and our partners talked at length with district attorneys across the state. Billy West was one of those district attorneys who talked with us, and I felt was very helpful and forthcoming in what he shared. And that included some pushback about our methods and some questions, and some of which we talked about a minute ago. And those are fair questions, and we perhaps could have done things differently. Not saying there's anything wrong with the way we did them, although others may disagree. But we had to make some choices that were tough in doing this investigation. But I valued having that conversation, and the district attorneys were open to us, and there were several across the state. Maybe in the data, the numbers didn't look that great. In fact, I will say there were several whose numbers looked really bad. This wasn't one of those counties that looked really bad, but there were some out there where the numbers were very low. And those district attorneys were willing to talk to us and had great conversations. Naturally, there were some whose numbers looked great. They were happy to have conversations. And some of those were featured in today's reporting, but some of them are scattered throughout the series. There were some locations where they did not want to talk to us. We did not want to talk to our partners. I had one organization, at least, that was a rape crisis center that said, we would have a problem if we were to talk to you from our center. and were concerned about pushback if we were to do that. And I thought that was very unfortunate. The whole point of this series was to begin some conversations. And I think those who are willing to talk about it and say, are there things we should be looking at? Are there things we could do better? Are there problems that people need to know about with juries or with the way we gather evidence or with resources? Do we need more saners? All of those were valuable. And so I have great respect for those political figures in the world, also some state leaders who spoke to us, who are willing to have those conversations. That to me is a great starting point. And so we really value that.
Well, I knew too when we first started reporting this series after I did my data analysis that we would have a lot of different reasons for why the rates are the way they are. And Cumberland County in particular is a very, you know, transient population given the bases that you have around this area. So there are a number of reasons why cases are dropped either by judges or by prosecutors or why they don't go forward at all. So, you know, I think the data is really just a starting point to ask questions and see, you know, what are the challenges? And like Frank said, is it because there's no sane nurse in far western North, you know, North Carolina, or is it because you have this different philosophy in this county as opposed to another county that might have a quote unquote better rate? You know, the way that you know, put victims forward if they want to swear and put their hand on the Bible and go to court, that's a different standard maybe than another county might have, where they feel like they can only go forward with charges if they really believe they're truly going to get a conviction. That's different. So that was.
Pass the microphone. No, but I want to piggyback on what you just said with another point that is crucial about Cumberland County. We look at the numbers. We looked at the whole state. Cumberland County by far had the highest number of defendants per capita in the county, in the state, of sexual assault defendants that qualified under this time window that we used. We used that time window because of the data we've been given, and we wanted to see cases that were apples to apples, defendant and the case completed, rather than looking at cases that were halfway in. One of the counties that had a very low number of defendants per capita was Forsyth County. It had an extremely high conviction rate, the way we calculate the conviction rate. Well, we noticed that, and our partners, the Winston-Salem Journal, asked them about that. And they had an answer. I'm not saying this is a good or a bad answer, but I found it an interesting answer. They said, well, we work with police to try to keep down having too many defendants that we don't think we can win those cases. That's an interesting philosophy, and it's not one we're hearing in most places in North Carolina. You know, I think that those numbers have to be looked at in that regard. That's what's happening. You guys have a big caseload. That's challenging here. And so that's a difference, you know, in this county that's unusual compared to a lot of the other counties out there. Yes?
And last little question for the state high. I very much appreciate the charge.
Any other questions? She's asking, once the kit has been collected, how long is that physical kit retained?
Post-analysis. It's already been analyzed. We've gotten the
live report on it? How long are they kept?
Yeah, so there's a lot of North Carolina biological evidence law, I think it came into effect 08 or 09, and it lists a few circumstances where the destruction of biological evidence, you know, that would be sexual assault kits, is permitted. But yeah, I know people around here know the kind of issues we had back in 2015 when we put out that over the years we destroyed several sexual assault kits. So I can only speak for my agency. I know we take a very conservative approach. We don't destroy any rape kits ever, regardless of the circumstances, just to avoid any potential future issues. So yeah, all of that is safe forever. After testing, before testing, if it's not tested, everything's safe forever. Sexual assault kits.
That's
us. Yeah, I know now.
Is there state law that mandates that the kit be preserved?
Yes. Yes, the North Carolina biological evidence law that came out in 08 or 09. And I'm not that versed on it because I know we save all of our kids. But I think, like, if there's a, if he pleads guilty and it's 3 years after the plea and he's not in prison, something like that, you can get rid of the biological evidence. Or obviously, if he's, you know, served his full sentence in prison. You know, there's a few circumstances where destruction of biological evidence is permitted per state law. I just know for us with sexual assault kits, we just choose to keep them all forever to avoid any problems in the future.
And with the tracking initiative that is in place now, would a survivor be notified prior to destruction of the physical evidence? Is that part of that tracking?
I don't think so, but let me back up on what he said. The new survivor law that Josh Stein put out a couple weeks ago, within that bill, it does address if law enforcement throws away, and it wasn't several, it was 333 that Fayetteville Newsmakers threw away, just to clarify. But he does address it. So it will be legal now for law enforcement to accidentally or purposely or for whatever reason throw away rape kits. So the state has addressed it. The bill has not passed, but it is in the bill.
Yeah, my jurisdiction threw away thousands, but my question wasn't leaning more towards about how many were thrown away.
Right.
It's just a concern about, because I'm focused on a dismissal, and in case that there's clarification of evidence or new evidence coming forward, is that kit preserved, and could, if it needed to be retested, would it be available to be retested, and how long would it be available for, even though it's already been analyzed? If it needed to be retested, would it be there? Is that part of Josh's new law?
Can you clarify what jurisdiction you're talking about?
Charlotte Network.
I'll find out for you. I know how to get with you. I'll look it up.
You know, we're doing this again in Mecklenburg County next week.
Oh, I'll be there.
Maybe we'll have an answer by that time to that question. That's a good question. Any other questions?
I did want to just point out real quick, we are a team here, and if you want to see my phone, you can see I've talked to LT, today's Tuesday, like 20 times this week already, right? So we are a team, but we're not perfect, and we recognize that. And this has made us recognize there's an issue at the, when we did the last one at the library, a victim had a concern about calling a rape crisis and always getting a different advocate, right? So we went back and we've had those discussions. How can we do better? What are we doing wrong? I'm sorry what's happened to you in your jurisdiction. But the importance of this team is that if a victim called probably any one of us and one of us are failing at what we're supposed to be doing, which is the right thing for the victim, we would call each other. Right, we just would, and And in that instance, it just wouldn't be acceptable that you're not getting your answers that you need from law enforcement or from the DA or from your advocate, right? That I want to say that just doesn't happen in this county anymore. It certainly used to, but we've worked really hard to not let that happen anymore. And I appreciate both of you coming forward and sharing. But we're, as the Advocacy Center, we are learning from you. We do a terrible job at following the court system. We do. I talked to LT and the sergeant today about that. Like, what can we do better to know, you know, 2 years from now when it gets to their level, I don't know it, right? I just don't know it. We're not tracking it. And that's on me. We need to start tracking that so you're not so alone in this process. And we're learning that and we're working on it and we're gonna fix it. I promise you we will. In our county.
Yeah. I just
wanna
commend you all at Great Crisis for doing a great job. I see Kelsey here. We work closely together on a lot of trials, and she makes sure I have good contact with my victims. And even before we dismiss a case when we've had no contact with victims, I'll call Kelsey to see if they've had any contacts with Great Crisis. If she has any leads on finding them, I'll also make sure I call the detective for them to track down any leads and locating them. So we try to exhaust all efforts to locate them before we take dismissals in those types of cases, because we do understand the facts and circumstances that surround these types of cases. Sometimes the victims move because they don't want to stay in this area where they've been assaulted and they have experiences associated with that trauma. So we do. We also have military advocates that we contact to try to locate them if they are dependents or active duty military. And I think the key to all of this and having this conversation is to continue with a collaborative effort so that everybody understands the roles that we have and the challenges that we do face, and that there's always open communication between us all to continue to improve how we do business.
I'll just say one thing about Kelsey. I have to compliment her. A few days ago, we worked with a victim, and Kelsey actually told her that she really bonded well with Kelsey. It actually helped us to be able to expedite and do our job when the advocates come in. But Kelsey had told her, when you call the Red Crisis Hotline, you can ask for me by name, and they will know how to get up with me. And that was just so supportive with that person, because once they bonded with you, there's a trust there. And these victims have to feel safe and they have to feel supported, otherwise they're not going to come forward. We see that a lot with kids, but we also see that with a lot of adults too, and I think that's why the Me Too movement is so big, that these people feel like they're with a friendly face, or they have a support system.
So I think one other thing to point out is some other reasons that prosecutors drop cases is because they may not have the evidence now, but they don't want to push ahead, because if there's an acquittal, then they can't ever charge that person with that crime again. It's called double jeopardy. And so when we're talking about cases like yours, perhaps, you know, maybe there's not evidence now. Do you want to address that?
I think that you hit the nail on the head. That's absolutely true. So if you don't have enough and you go forward and you get a not guilty, there's nothing can do beyond that. That's the end of the road. Now, if you don't have enough now and you end up taking dismissal, which isn't ideal either, but that's kind of the position that you're in, and later on, say, a hit comes back or whatever evidence comes up, at that point, since there is no statute of limitations, we can then recharge and move forward. And at that point, we certainly are in a better position than we were when it was initially charged.
Could you address a little bit more about issues of consent law in the state? I think that's interesting. I don't know for who, but I know North Carolina's got some unique aspects.
Right. So she's asking about the consent law in the state. Would you like to explain what it is, and then if that's a problem for your office?
With
yes, withdrawal.
Yes.
Withdrawal consent. That's what I mean. Yeah. Do you want to?
Yeah, so the withdrawn consent, yeah, it's like some old 1970s case law from some judge who got his law degree in World War II, probably. So yeah, it's kind of dated, sorry. you know, I know I discussed this in Charlotte a little bit. Yeah, it's just something I've discussed with our legal advisors, and certainly if sorry, Billy, if we choose to, it's case law, so it's something that can be, I guess we can try and create our own case law. I'm sorry, I'm not a lawyer, I'm not qualified to say this, but I've talked to our legal advisor who said, with Mr. West's permission, and if the circumstances were right, it'd have to be a specific set of circumstances, maybe. Maybe we can try and challenge case law, put it out there. So yeah, we run into that occasionally, not a whole lot. And when we do, unfortunately, that's just sometimes one of those cases we discuss with our team at the DA's office, and then we just have to respectfully, you know, break the bad news to the survivor that no, now we can't, but it's being worked on. I think it's being worked on at the state legislature level too. I think we've got some people there working on it. And if I figure out a way to create some case law, I'm all about that. So we'll work with Mr. West. Maybe we'll find that one case that'll get us there. And yeah, shaking your head, huh? But yeah, certainly that's something that is being worked on at a few different levels, at least you know, in this state, to my understanding.
We actually have the fourth story in the series. It's going to run Thursday. We talked with the representative Beasley, who's on the other side of the assembly, who's working with that issue also. And in fact, he's going to be on our panel in Raleigh tomorrow. This is an issue. For those of you who are not familiar with it, North Carolina is the only state in which, during a sexual act, if a person says stop and they revoke consent. So it started out as a consensual act. The person involved in the act says, stop, I don't want to go through with it. It's not waiting for the other person to continue in North Carolina. Only state in the union. It's based entirely not on a statute, but on case law, as I mentioned, from the 1970s. And there I've even seen opinions from the school government, not the attorneys who know the law very well, saying, if this was tested, we wonder whether it would be upheld. Nevertheless, it stands as the law of the land at the moment in North Carolina, and it certainly has a chilling effect, I would think, on being able to prosecute cases where this is an issue. So this is something that's going to be continued to be looked at in the legislature. My understanding is during some of the recent sessions, it was difficulty getting it to come up for a vote, even if it had been proposed. We'll see what happens this time, as we think that it's likely to be brought up. Anybody else want to? Yes?
I have a question on the statute of limitations, which I know is not going to apply to North Carolina, but a statute of limitations is really just referring to the victim reporting it. It's not a statute of limitations on when it can be brought forward and charged, right? So, like in Georgia, it's 5 years. It doesn't deal with reporting, unfortunately. It is when the act happened and then when the charges are brought.
Are there exceptions to that in cases, for instance, if there was intimidation by a child, a
know we're primarily talking about adult sexual cases, but are there cases of a sexual nature where there was a statute for that homosexual case?
I can't think of one. I mean, I don't want to say any absolutes, but statute of limitations is pretty strict. So if you have it and it's, you know, for whatever reason you cannot bring the charge within that time period, you're almost absolutely barred. And I mean, there could be exceptions, so I don't want to say that there aren't any, but it's, I would imagine it's very, very rare.
But the statute of limitations for rape, there isn't
one? There is not one in North Carolina.
Okay, no statute.
Oh,
for any felony.
Okay, so the question here, there's a statute of limitations on rape in Georgia?
Yes.
But there's not one on Georgia?
That's correct.
Okay.
Do we have any more questions? Because we could ask a few more. Okay. Well, we've been good question askers from the audience because you've covered a few of the ones we were planning on asking our panel anyway. But this is for the assistant district attorneys. From your perspective, what, if anything, can be done to improve the process?
I think the main thing is what we've talked about, what Ms. Marks had commented on, is being collaborative in our efforts on improving how we do investigations, how we communicate, and getting corroborative evidence. That is an education. So those are probably the main things. Education, collaboration, and corroborating evidence. And if we can improve all of those things, I think we can improve the process. And again, I say this, we don't do it to get higher conviction rates. If that is a byproduct, then, and that's what justice looks like, and that's because that's the right outcome, then that's great. But we do it, we have to be led by the law, and we have to be led by the evidence. And if we can improve the processes in order to get justice or better justice or whatever that looks like for the victim in that case, then that is our goal, and that's what our goal has to be at the end of the day, what justice looks like for each case.
Just to piggyback off of what she said, I think when a jurisdiction is motivated by conviction rates, you end up with numbers that look like Forsyth, where it's closer to 100%, but that's because they're discouraging law enforcement from charging certain types of cases and only going forward on cases where they know that it's a slam dunk and you can guarantee a conviction. And that's not what we're doing here. We have a multidisciplinary team that works very well together. And like I said many times before, we encourage law enforcement not to stop at probable cause and continue, you know, to do things that can collaborate the victim's account, because juries expect more. Every time we lose a case, we go back in that room. Sometimes we take the detectives with us. I don't know, Deanne, if you've been in there, but we try to take as many people in the room as we can and talk to them and see what they want. And they want more than just the victim's account. It's not about whether they believe it or not. It's about whether or not we've proved it beyond a reasonable doubt, and they do want some type of corroboration during the trial. We continue to work towards that.
We've been talking a lot about a comparison between Forsyth and Cumberland, and I want to give you guys kind of an idea of what I'm talking about when we're talking about defendants charged for 100,000. So Forsyth has a little over two defendants charged for 100,000 within our study period, with these serious rape crimes that we're talking about, and Cumberland has 31. So if you kind of look at it from a math perspective, that's a little over 15 times what Forsyth is, so that's a big difference.
So, Deanne, the question I had for you is actually one that you've already partially answered, which is, it's about things that you've done recently that you see as improving the process. You mentioned working to try to ensure that the coordination with the same person who dealt with the person initially, so they'll have that point of contact. Anything else that you can think of that is worth mentioning, or things that you can think of that you'd like to see happen in the near future as you work with survivors so often as the first point of entry into the system that could maybe be improved on and you'd like to see happen? Has that
advocacy point of view, we look at it a little bit differently than maybe the rest of the panel. Our end goal is not a conviction. Our end goal is for the victim to be able to survive in whatever way that needs to be done. I've been to several rape trials, and they're horrific for victims. They just really are. I mean, they get torn apart on the stand, and so I'm not all about, like, get them to a trial to get a conviction. I'm not, and I'm just not. So as an agency, we are constantly reminding victims to redefine what justice looks like for them. Justice may look like being able to get out of bed in the morning. That can be justice. I shared with someone today, I don't remember who, this year alone, we've been invited three times on Fort Bragg to see soldiers who are victims get promoted. That is justice. They have been promoted in a system that was pretty bad to them. And that's justice, right? Feeding your kids is justice. Being able to go back to work is justice. So that's how we look at it, and we want to help victims to redefine it. It is not going to be a Law and Order episode, like we discussed before, where it all magically just happens in 60 minutes and he's in jail for the rest of his life. It's just not going to happen that way, no matter what.
One of the things that we try to discourage from law enforcement or from our physicians, and I think we've gotten much better, but the one thing we don't want to do is guilt that victim into it's the right thing to report, or if you don't report, this could happen to someone else. I actually heard someone say, he could come after you again. That's not right to guilt that victim into doing that, because they have to do what is right for them. And they don't need to be guilted into taking care of anybody else at that point but themselves.
This is a question from Lieutenant Somerindyke. So what is your reaction to the arrest and conviction rates in Cumberland County? And before this whole forum started, you also shared some of your thoughts regarding the statewide figures as well.
Yeah, I was really, just as a citizen of North Carolina, I think the bigger story is the lack of number of rape arrests in the state. No doubt your numbers are accurate. I think you guys did a phenomenal job, for one thing, for all the research you did. I mean, I'm a numbers nerd, like you apparently are, so I really appreciate the research you guys did on that. But the statewide numbers are pretty low. I mean, I think, first, my profession has a long way to go. We got room for improvement for sure on that end. As far as that 16%, I really do appreciate the work you guys did. I think anytime any media outlets promoting public awareness for sexual assaults, you're helping me sell my product, which is encouraging victims to come forward, which is what we want. That 16%, I'll quote a man who I respect quite a bit. There's the 18th Airborne Corps Commander, General Paul McCamara. Those that are local might have heard his name. I've heard him say on more than one occasion, he's one of the coolest dudes I know too, so I've heard him say on more than one occasion, there's lies, there's damn lies, and then there's statistics. And again, with all due respect, you guys did a phenomenal job. I'm gonna have to put that 16% in his statistics category for now. I mean, it really unfairly reflects, we've been beating a dead horse up here, that sexual assault response team in Cumberland County, our multidisciplinary team through our Sexual Assault Kit Initiative grant, I think it really downplays as a team what we got going on here. And somebody mentioned smaller jurisdictions not having a SART, maybe Liz. There's larger cities and larger jurisdictions who don't talk to each other, and they hear about what we got here in Cumberland County, and they're t- telling me what you talk to advocates. You talk to Sames, you got that good a relationship with the DA's office. So there's larger agencies in this country nationwide that I've come across that don't have what we have here. So yeah, again, great job on that. The 16%, I'll put a whole lot into it because I know it doesn't reflect what we're doing here. And I'd really be also interested in the average caseload for your Superior Court Assistant District Attorney, because I think these two ladies probably got the two highest caseloads in the state for all the cases we're putting that way. Not just with rapes. I think if you're from Fayetteville, you know we have our share of violent crime. But we always jump on it. My agency, I'm proud of my agency, we always jump on violent crime. We have a high number of homicide arrests, not just rape arrests, a high number of aggravated assault arrests, high number of armed robberies or arrests. We send a lot of work their way. There's only so many hours in the week for them to work on it. So I hope that answered it.
Thank you. Yeah, and I want to reemphasize something else about the numbers we did. We realized there were conversations and hidden things that the data doesn't tell the whole story. So let's, have those conversations. We say, we look at sexual assault, but what about murder? Well, yeah, we're glad that you guys are taking murderers off the street. Don't get me wrong. This just happens to be a project looking at sexual assaults. And so we wanted to have that conversation about sexual assaults. We wanted it to be data-based, and we wanted to be able to look at the entire state to begin that. We recognize there are much deeper stories. That case flow in Cumberland County does come out of the numbers. We do see that. And it was something that jumped out at us immediately. It's like they're really dealing with a difficult, challenging situation in Cumberland County. And while compared to counties that have a very low number of arrests, it doesn't look like the conviction rate is as high as some of those. We have a different situation here entirely than these counties that are not really picking anybody up. So we recognize that. I wanted to ask a question of Liz. You mentioned a minute ago that you're not necessarily trying to get a victim to say you don't want to guilt victims into proceeding. How often, when you're working with survivors, do you see that the answer, though, as they go independently, they say, I don't want to proceed? Any idea what kind of percentage that is, and how difficult, is it for a survivor that maybe is on the fence about it to come around and say, I think I do want to go after them?
Many of our victims, when they arrive to the emergency department, there is a high anxiety. Many of them don't even know that they want to pursue a kit, that they want to report. We don't push them. We start doing what we do. We take care of that patient medically. I would say probably 90% of the time that victim will go ahead and say they do want to do a kit. And we explain their options. You don't have to report right now. This is just evidence that we possibly can't come back and get if you wait a few days and, there's been some showers and changing of clothes. Because all that stuff affects our ability to collect DNA and perpetrator DNA. But we don't force those victims. But 90% of the time, those victims will, once you have established that bonding and you work with them a little while, they feel safe, they feel supported, they've got that one continuous sane nurse, they would typically go ahead and report. Our anonymous kits, and I don't have an actual number, but I would imagine they account for less than 5% of our overall kits. I don't have that exact number, but that would be my guess.
I want to thank you all. It's 8 o'clock, and just to be respectful of everyone's time, everyone in there, if you all can talk with one another and with our panelists, if they'll stick around for a little bit. On behalf of our nonprofit news organization, everyone at Carolina Public Press really appreciates all of you. We appreciate the Fayetteville Observer for being part of the collaboration on this reporting project. We certainly appreciate all of you for coming and talking and answering questions, sharing your thoughts and opinions and your potential solutions to this issue. So thank you again. And